So let us continue on the topic that we have for today. I'm going to be doing the discussion about the last two portions of this book of Numbers. It's a double portion this week. Mattot-Masei. So I've called this Whose Land, and the reason will be quite apparent. I'm going to be talking about something I've talked about before. I've talked about the land of Israel before, the biblical land. I will be talking about this again, but I will be talking about this in sort of a bit more detail than last time, and it's changing some of the aspects of the conversation. So I will be continuing on from here. As you can see, we've got the prophet's readings as well as the New Testament readings as well listed on the screen. So let's go through sort of the context of the book, of this particular portion. We've got, of course, the end of the book of Numbers. We're about to finish it. Sorry, Numbers should be capital letters there. It's the end of the book of Numbers. In terms of some quite detailed specifics of the chapter, there's a few sort of major categories of topics that were discussed. We read about how a man can annul his wife's or daughter's vows. And this is, again, a topic in, you know, by itself, actually, but I don't have time to go into that today, but that's its own discussion as well. Israel also goes to battle Midian as revenge for the previous, as you guys remember, the Midianites sent their women to entice Israel to observe their gods, to observe Baal. So as you can see over here, Israel actually goes out to avenge this and battles and beats Midian as well. We also read about Reuben and Gad, those two tribes asking Moses for their inheritance in the land to be on the east side of the Jordan. So I've called it here the east bank of the Jordan River. And basically they see the land there, it's quite lush, good land. They basically say, we want this as our inheritance. Now, after some discussion and after some deliberation about this, Moses does agree on the condition that Gad and Reuben send their fighting men with the rest of Israel to conquer their inheritance as well. So that is agreed to at the end. The journey throughout the desert is summarized completely as well. We sort of have a bit of a rundown of where they went throughout the 40 years. And this is where the wandering finally ends. So when once we get to Deuteronomy, they're about to enter the land. It's actually mostly Moses talking throughout most of Deuteronomy. So the wandering through the desert, that narrative is coming to a close. And also, this week's portion in Masei, the sort of latter part of the portion this week, it gives the boundaries of the land of Israel. So that's what I'm going to be talking about today, the biblical land of Israel. What is it? So before I continue on to that, the prophet's readings are mostly a call for Israel to repent and return to God, reminding Israel of their sins. The Luke portion this week explains that all those who do not repent will perish. And also we read about, not only in Luke, but in the Mark portion, the parable of the fig tree. So the fig tree doesn't produce good fruit, will be destroyed. So that's so used as a metaphor for us. If you don't produce good fruit, if you don't produce good deeds, then we will be also cast away and destroyed. So, sort of lost within the current climate of, you know, coronavirus and everything that's gone on there, there's actually been a fairly big issue going on in Israel, which is apart from the coronavirus. The momentum for this issue has been sort of cooled off as of late, but there was a push by the Israeli government to annex parts of Judea and Samaria, also known as the West Bank. So actually to incorporate the territories which contain the largest settlements. I'm sure many of you will be familiar with this issue where, and I will explain it in more detail, but essentially there is a push in Israel at the moment. Perhaps you know, in the current climate, it's maybe an opportunity to do so, to annex part of the Judea and Samaria, annex part of the West Bank. And this, of course, even in the current climate, has drawn some criticism from around the world, particularly from Arab and European leaders. And the politics regarding the whole situation are very complicated, as you know. I'm not going to dwell on the politics too much, but I will try and present a biblical point of view as to this topic. And this topic is essentially, you know, the land. Whose land? What is the land? And what does this mean for us? So, this talk would have been so much easier with a whiteboard as opposed to being on camera, but I will try my best. I've sort of included a picture here of Israel and her neighbors. You can see here, I've included this picture on purpose. It includes what is accepted as Israel in the yellow. You sort of see the sort of bright, almost fluorescent yellow in the middle. That's Israel. That is the accepted boundaries of Israel according to international rules. We can also see Egypt to the southwest, Jordan to the east, Syria to the northeast, and we've got Lebanon the far north there as well. But we can also see within sort of the boundaries of Israel, we can see some dark green areas. And I don't have a pointer, I don't have a way to mark this, but I'll just try and describe it as best as I can. We've got sort of very close to Jerusalem in the middle, we've got almost like a, I'm not even sure how to describe that shape, but essentially you've got a shape in the middle, so roughly near the middle of the land of Israel, you've got some dark green there. That's called the West Bank. It's called Judea and Samaria in the biblical terminology. That's the territories there. We also got the Gaza Strip in the southwest near Egypt, and also the Golan Heights just in the northeast close to Syria. So the total, as you guys will remember, when Israel was declared as a state, Israel went to war with her neighbors, unfortunately. The original UN partition lines were quite different to this, but essentially Israel won the war, and won in a defensive war. She was attacked, and there were some ceasefire lines, which were essentially the internationally accepted boundaries, and it's called the Green Line today. And the Green Line makes the boundaries of the yellow portion. So that yellow portion of Israel that you see, they're the boundaries according to the Green Line. So that was the sort of the ceasefire boundaries after the War of Independence in 1948 to 1949. And that area is approximately 20,770 square kilometers. That's the total area of that yellow land. If we include the dark green bits, so the West Bank, the Gaza Strip, and the Golan Heights, you can build it to about almost 28,000 square kilometers, very close, 27,799. Now, for a bit of context as to how small that land is, if you think about Tasmania, so a very small island state south of where we are now, that state is 68,401 square kilometers. And even Metro Melbourne, so the area of Melbourne currently in lockdown during this coronavirus episode, the area of Metro Melbourne is just under 10,000 square kilometers. So Metro Melbourne is quite a large area. It goes all the way from sort of Yarra Ranges in the east. You go up north to sort of, almost up to Mernda up there. And it's down to Mornington, west to sort of past Werribee. So it's quite a big area. But even Metro Melbourne is just under 10,000 square kilometers. So Metro Melbourne is almost half the land of Israel within the Green Line. So it's really, we're talking about very small areas in, Israel is a small country. And just to compare here, so, we've got little Tasmania down the bottom on the left here. That's 68,000 square kilometers. That's, over three times of Israel's size, just that state. And you've got Melbourne Metro here. So this is a picture I took from ABC website, which was showing the lockdown areas. And you can see here, Melbourne Metro area was locked down. Also Mitchell Shire is not part of the Melbourne Metro area. That's a rural council area, so I've sort of excluded that from the measurement. But the rest of the blue area on the right hand picture is almost 10,000 square kilometers. So that's almost half of the Green Line area of Israel. So again, we're talking about a very small country here. And just to bring it into comparison to Australia's total land mass is 7,692,000 square kilometers. So again, Australia is gigantic, but also Israel is very small. So this is to give you the context of what sort of land we're talking about. We're talking about a tiny piece of land in the grand scheme of things. And even though this land is tiny, it has, of course, massive significance, not only to Jews, but also to all Abrahamic faiths and also in world politics, probably disproportionately so. But this week, we do read about the boundaries of the land. So I will read that for us today from Numbers 34, verses 1 to 12. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Command the people of Israel and say to them, when you enter the land of Canaan, that this is the land that shall fall to you for an inheritance, the land of Canaan as defined by its borders. Your south side shall be from the wilderness of Zin alongside Edom, and your southern border shall run from the end of the Salt Sea on the east. And your border shall turn south of the ascent of Akrabim and cross to Zin, and its limits shall be south of Kadesh Barnea. Then it shall go on to Hazar Adar and pass along to Azmon. And the border shall turn from Azmon to the brook of Egypt, and its limit shall be the sea. For the western border, you shall have the great sea and its coast. This shall be your western border. This shall be your northern border. From the great sea, you shall draw a line to Mount Hor. From Mount Hor, you shall draw a line to Lebo Hamat. And the limit of the border shall be at Zedad. Then the border shall extend to Ziphron, and its limit shall be at Hazar Enan. This shall be your northern border. You shall draw a line for your eastern border from Hazar Enan to Shepham. And the border shall go down from Shepham to Riblah on the east side of Ain. And the border shall go down and reach to the shoulder of the Sea of Kinneret on the east. And the border shall go down the Jordan, and its limit shall be at the Salt Sea. This shall be your land as defined by its borders all around. So, there's a lot of unfamiliar names here. I'm sure, you know, to the average listener, Hazar Enan and Zedad is not very helpful. I'm sure the only ones really recognized would probably be the Salt Sea. So that's the Dead Sea, in other words, the Yam HaMelech in Hebrew, literally, the Salt Sea. And obviously the Kinneret is the Sea of Galilee, and the Great Sea is the Mediterranean. So those things are useful, but I think it's better illustrated with a picture. So I've used this picture before, but I think it's really the best picture I found to illustrate this. So again, would have been much easier on a whiteboard rather than on camera, but as you can see here, the red lines, so the red boundaries, dictate what the understood boundaries would have been according to the Book of Numbers. So according to what we've just read, that would have been the boundary of Israel. And you can see also, it's very useful, this map, because it gives a color coding as to the modern country. So you can see you've got Egypt in purple, you've got Jordan in blue, Israel inside the green line is green, the West Bank is in gray, Lebanon is in yellow, Syria is in red. So very useful, you can actually see that according to the Book of Numbers, and you've also got in blue the book of the description according to the Book of Ezekiel is very similar. So that's why it's included together. According to these two descriptions, you've got here essentially most of Lebanon, parts of Syria, and essentially most of the current land, including the West Bank, including Gaza, more or less down to the middle of the Negev. So the area of Eilat today, which would be the very south and southern tip, would not be in the biblical land. That was part of Edom, which is sort of the desert land to the south. Included on this map, I've sort of shown here, in the dark blue shaded circle just to the east of the Jordan, that's the land roughly where Gad and Reuben would have had their inheritance, so on the east bank. And I've also made a note on the left here. So the Brook of Egypt, that was the description of the western border, the southern border. And people sometimes assume that would be the Nile River. But actually, the Brook of Egypt is probably not the Nile, because the Nile is actually called Hayeh Or in Exodus 7:18, but the word here is Nachal, which is just a small stream. So it's probably not the Nile River, probably a dried up small river, which no longer exists. But that's the approximate land according to the description today. Now, from any biblical definition of the land of Israel, the West Bank is definitely within the land. So biblically speaking, again, not considering politics, but considering the Bible, occupied territory of the West Bank is completely an oxymoron. Like, the biblical point of view is that all that land in this territory is actually, you know, biblical land of Israel. So the West Bank is very much fair game. It's just as much as the rest of Israel inside the Green Line. If anything, if you want to talk about occupied land, maybe the southern tip of Israel close to Eilat, you could consider occupied land, because that wasn't in the biblical definition. But the green line, you know, what's inside is obviously, of course, the land of Israel, but also what's outside of that in terms of the West Bank is also considered part of the biblical land. However, politics does make it more complicated, as we know, and I don't think that politics is completely unrelated. I do think it's important to consider what the political climate is. Today, of course, Israel is not occupying her full biblical land. However, what people don't realize is that even in ancient times, Israel never fully occupied her allotted land either. And many times, God actually criticizes Israel for not actually occupying their full land. And Israel has never occupied all the land that was given to her in this promise. So all this land that you see here, Israel never fully at one time occupied entirety at once. It never actually happened. Even throughout the glory days of Israel's history, we got very close, but it was never completely occupied. Now, there are also other ways to describe the boundaries of Israel as well. So the very, very common phrase, from Dan to Beersheba. So Dan to Beersheba, which is presumably the northernmost and the southernmost cities of Israel. So Dan is in the Galilee. In this map over here, it's hard to describe, but you see here the junction between the green and the yellow territory, the junction between Israel and Lebanon, you got Tel Dan. That was the city of Dan. And Beersheba is in the southern part of that land. So that's another way of describing the land of Israel. So that's obviously a smaller land than all of this land highlighted here. So that's the most common, actually, description of the land of Israel, and that is referred to approximately 9 times. And I've listed the references here. Mostly, you know, they're all throughout the prophets. Other different definitions are also talked about here. So in the book of Genesis, when the Lord makes a covenant with Abram at the time and says, "To your descendants I will give this land, from the stream of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates, the land of the Kenites, Kenizzites, Cabanites, Hittites, Perizzites, Rephaites, Amorites, Canaanites, Girgashites, and Jebusites." Again, that's actually also a different border, which I will also explain. Exodus 23:31 is very similar. "I will establish your borders from the Red Sea to the Mediterranean Sea, and from the desert to the Euphrates River. I will give into your hands the people who live in the land, and you will be driven, and you will drive them out before you." And the Ezekiel 47 section is quite lengthy. I won't quote it here, but it's very similar to the Numbers portion. So we've got really 3 main descriptions. We've got the description in this week's portion, Numbers, and Ezekiel matching up, which looks roughly like the picture that we saw just now. We've also got here the Dan to Beersheba references, the 9 total references, which talk about actually a smaller land, only from sort of the upper Galilee down to Beersheba, which is the top of the Negev. So that's actually a much smaller land. And we've also got here Genesis 15 and Exodus 23, which talks about a much bigger land. And that much bigger land looks like this, the next slide. You can see this picture. And this picture goes all the way from the Nile River in Egypt all the way to the Euphrates, which is Iraq. So that's a gigantic land, as you can see. And Israel has never come close to occupying such a big land. So if you actually took out, if you took the Genesis and Exodus portions, this is the land of Israel. Because it goes from the River of Egypt and the Mediterranean, which is the western border, as you can see, all the way to the Euphrates, which is the northeast. And if you sort of draw a line between them, you get this rough area here, which essentially encompasses some of Egypt. You got Israel, Lebanon, a lot of Syria, all of the Jordan, parts of Saudi Arabia, and parts of Iraq. So a humongous piece of land here. Again, do I think that this is literally the promised land? I don't. I do think that there are some ways to understand this, and I will sort of try and explain the differences. Why do we have different boundaries described in the scriptures? I don't exactly know the answer for sure, so I won't pretend to know, but I do think that there are some possibilities which explains why there are different boundaries explained at different times. So I'll give 3 main reasons, or 3 main ideas. So I've called the first reason a biblical approach because it's sort of... it relies more specifically on the Peshat, on the simple text. And there is some biblical evidence that the small definitions of the land were a sort of baseline, and that God would allow Israel to expand their borders under the right circumstances. In other words, if they kept the commandments. And the reason I give this is because there's a couple of hints to that in the rest of Scripture. So I'll read Deuteronomy 19, verse 8. It says, "If the Lord your God enlarges your territory, as he promised an oath to your ancestors, and gives you the whole land he promised them." So there's a hint here that God would, under the right circumstances, enlarge their territory and give the whole land, which in this context would mean the land beyond the boundaries that we read, which would be the whole land as according to Exodus and Genesis. So that would be if Israel obeyed God. And Joel chapter 3, verse 2 also says, "I will gather all nations and bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat. There I will put them on trial for what they did to my inheritance." So here God's talking to the nations. "My people Israel, because they scattered my people among the nations and divided up my land." So here, God is criticizing the nations for conquering parts of Israel's land, and he will judge them for this. So that sort of implies that even when Israel was at its maximum extent, that there is evidence that there was even a greater extent which they could have had, and God is angry that the nations kept Israel from this. So again, it's not really direct evidence per se, but there are a couple of hints as to perhaps a bigger land. Now, God expressing his anger over the division of Israel's land implies that maybe the actual boundaries of Israel were not actually God's original design, but was rather the reality inflicted upon her by her enemies. And as we read in different places in the scripture, if Israel would not obey God, the land would vomit them out. And that's perhaps what's happening here. Now, a second idea that I had is the messianic approach, I call this. So the reason I call this the messianic approach is I'm relying on a commentary called Tevuot Haaretz, or Tevuot Saharetz. It's written in the 19th century by a rabbi, Joseph Schwartz. And basically his idea was that the full border was indeed to the Euphrates. So the full borders were indeed that gigantic piece of land, but that would only occur during the Messianic era. So before then, the borders would be roughly the state of Israel today, but in the Messianic era, it would be expanded. So in other words, he describes them as the Messianic borders of Israel. And it's an interesting topic. It's an interesting parable here. Like, I'm not sure. I mean, I don't think that there's much direct scriptural evidence for this, but it's an interesting way of reconciling the differences. So I will give him credit here for quite an ingenious interpretation. And I've called my third reason a spiritual response. So I'm relying here on another commentary. It's called Pesikta Rabbati. It's from a collection of legends or midrashim collated in the 9th century of the Common Era. So I'll read a part of it here. It says, in the future, the land of Israel will spread and encompass all the lands of the earth. The entire Temple Mount will become like the Holy of Holies. All of Jerusalem will become like the Temple Mount. All of Israel will become like Jerusalem, and all of the world will become like Israel. So this is meant in a spiritual sense. It doesn't literally mean that Israel will conquer the world, but rather the world would unite and in holiness. And also this spirit of God, this understanding of God, this holiness would fill the earth, and everyone would help each other serve the same God. According to this view, the outcome of Abraham's seed blessing the world would not be the literal spreading of his seed to the Euphrates. It wouldn't be a literal conquering of that land. It would essentially be a metaphorical way to explain that the knowledge and the service of God will spread throughout the whole earth. And if you sort of thought about the context in which that was written, in that time, very, very ancient times, the Mesopotamian civilization, where it essentially went from, you know, around the Euphrates River, was the extent of the known world. So it makes sense from that context to have a spiritual metaphorical interpretation of this. So in summary, this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. So it's from Matthew 24, verse 14. And this really speaks to the spiritual fulfillments of this land, in the sense that, you know, it's not only the expanding of political boundaries, it's also the expansion of the knowledge of God throughout the world. It was supposed to come from Israel and spread throughout the world. And in some ways, in many ways it did. We do have, of course, the gospel did originate in Israel and it has spread throughout the world. So this is definitely coming true. So I will try and summarize what we've learned today. In summary, if you're looking at a strictly simple text, Peshat, biblical point of view, the land that Israel plans to annex, again, it might not happen, but the land they plan to annex, it's not even the whole West Bank, it's actually only very specific parts of it, but that land actually belongs to them as promised. Like, if you look at the scripture, there is nothing that you can argue to say that this land does not belong to the children of Israel. However, I will also balance this by practical realities, and practical realities are nothing to ignore. The reality is politics and social concerns do play a role, and they do influence how we've occupied the land. So even throughout ancient history, these concerns actually prevented Israel from occupying the land. And there were a variety of reasons for this. Sometimes it was inflicted on them by God, sometimes it's inflicted upon themselves, but there were, for many reasons, Israel didn't fully step into the full occupation of the land. And I think actually today, with the spirit of Messiah in our hearts, we should actually have more concern, perhaps even more concern than the ancient Israelites did, for the people in the land too. So I'm not one of those people that suggest that we should just blow up everything and burn down everything and, you know, have a conquest of the land 2.0. I do think we do need to have consideration and care for the people living there, even if those people are perceived to be our enemies sometimes, the Arabs who are living there. I do think as believers in Yeshua, we do need to have care and consideration and allow these people to live in dignity and peace as well. I don't think it's good enough to say it's biblically our land, therefore we can do whatever we like. I do think we need to balance the two. So having said that, yes, biblically it's our land, but at the same time, we do need to have care for people who are there. So I don't think we can ignore one and focus too much and too extremely on the other. So I want to give a balanced approach to this. But from a pure biblical Peshat point of view, you know, the world calling it occupied territory is complete nonsense, and I'll leave that there.